Moving on to our next session, we have the first panel discussion of the day. The topic for the panel is Content Strategy for Purposeful Brand Building. The panel will be moderated by Nazmul Karim Chaudhary, marketer and brand evangelist, doctoral researcher, IBA, University of Dhaka. The other members of the panel are Muhammad Sajjad Haseeb, Chief Marketing Officer, Grameen Phone Limited, Tanzeem Firdaus Alam, Lead Firm of the Future, Unilever Bangladesh Limited, Alan Ebenezer Eric, Director, Marketing, Marico Bangladesh Limited, Jani Alam Rommel, Group Chief Marketing Officer, IDLC Finance Limited.
Dear audience, it is paradoxical that while there is an ample evidence that globalization and capitalism have helped destroy poverty in the world, trust in brands and companies is on the ground. Many consumers look at brands with skepticism and as a cause of their problems, not as part of the solution. At the same time, there is evidence that sales elasticity to conventional advertising spending has decreased in recent decades. Some marketing departments stick to traditional branding strategies. Others have opted for new media or new creative paths, trying to hyper-segment and trying to reach customers with a new language. In many cases, however, the brand equity has been eroded. In the annual report of many organizations, statement on the purpose of a corporation reflects a gradual but profound shift in the consciousness of top management. We see more and more companies taking seriously, having a positive impact on society. Some go from simply investing in a set of social initiatives to seek a social purpose intimately linked to everything they do. It is in these companies where the brand cannot be left out. A brand with purpose is not a brand that uses some social initiatives to guide its marketing and communication. It is a brand whose identity is inseparable from a social purpose. In this session, we will discuss what a purposeful brand is and whether embracing the concept makes sense for any company, and if it does, how to build it through content marketing. I believe that an exciting discussion is ahead of us, as our panel today consists of some of the leading minds from telecommunications, fast-moving consumer goods, and financial service industry. We have Muhammad Sajjad Haseeb, Chief Marketing Officer, Grameen Phone Limited. Welcome, Sajjad Bhai.
Assalamu alaikum.
We have Tanzeem Firdaus, Firm of the Future, Unilever Bangladesh Limited. Welcome, Tanzeem Bhai.
Hello. Hi.
We have Alan Ebenezer, Director Marketing, Marico Bangladesh Limited. Hi, Alan. And we have Jani Alam Rommel, Group Chief Marketing Officer, IDLC Finance Limited.
Hello, Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Bhai. And I'm Nazmul Karim Chaudhary, Doctor Researcher at IBA, Dhaka University, and I'm going to moderate this awesome session. Thank you everyone for joining us. Research shows that reaching exceptional status occurs when marketing pursues both purpose and practicality. I mean the functionality. Customers are most satisfied when they buy something that fulfills their everyday needs and simultaneously contributes to an ideal that they believe in. This dual benefit on both the individual and social level should be clear throughout every stage of our marketing. So in my first question of the session, I would like to know, how can brands develop a very balanced multi-level content strategy that speaks to both purpose and practicality? So let's start with Sajjad Haseeb from Grameenphone. We all know that he represents Grameenphone, who has been in this industry, you know, like leading these brands with social purpose for a long time. So Sajjad Bhai, could you please enlighten us with something where you believe that purpose and functionality can come together to create the multi-level content strategy? Sajjad Bhai.
Thank you, Rajul bhai. I hope I am loud and clear.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. All right.
So thank you and thanks everyone, and good afternoon to this amazing audience we have today. And this is a very, very important subject in the field of marketing, which is brand and contents. So before actually, I would like to talk about a little bit about the brand and the content, that why do we actually marketeers content are so important for us. And if I talk about the brand and what is a brand, it's nothing but the identity of the company or the product or the way it makes the customers or consumers feel about the product. Do you feel adventurous, emotional, exciting, or whatever it is, safe, secured? So it's the identity of the brand which actually instigates the different emotional attributes of a customer. Rarely we see brands can differentiate through functional or futuristic initiatives. So it is obviously very, very important for the companies to create that appeal. And that appeal comes through purpose. And because we cannot actually touch our customers' hearts or minds without having a true purpose, which actually connects. And time and again, over the last 100 years or so in organizations, we have seen how the companies have really touched the hearts of the customers through their purpose and being aspirational, inspirational, adventurous, or whatever they want to instigate. And in that subject, the part of the contents come in a really important manner, that how are we really instigating those contents to live our purpose. Now, if I come to our example of the brand Grameenphone, our purpose has always been to empower the societies, and it is something we have been living for last more than 24 years. We have not changed or deviated from the purpose, because it actually inspires us to do more. And in a country like Bangladesh, it has a lot of potentials to go and beyond and develop. And we have seen that we are an integral part of this journey. Hence, we continue to live on that purpose. And if you talk about our mission is actually to deliver and connect to our customers with what that matters most to them, that what matters most. And that is actually, you can say, the short and long term, balance. So whereas we have the empowered societies, which is a more of a vision or a purpose, whereas the root of delivering that is through connectivity. So that's how we are always living. If I give you couple of examples in the recent one and a half years, like I'll give you one very recent and then couple of one or two here and there. In August, we all celebrate this international Friendship Day in the first Sunday of August. And we saw this amazing opportunity that people are in lockdown. Everybody is so depressed. We should do something about it. And youth is particularly, confined in the houses. So we brought this Bondhu campaign, where we recreated a couple of old songs through the most popular artists. And then we connected the universities, the 12 university students to join in the recreation of this song. And it was like, with the power of the connectivity and with the power of the togetherness and the youth. Now, we have seen amazing response, and it got the highest shares in the Facebook and the YouTube in the early first week of August. Now, why did we do this? This is exactly something that fits with our mission, that we are doing what is important to our customers. And with the power of technology and with the power of the youth, we are connecting this. This is relevant. And that's how the short term. And again, if you talk about couple of quarters back, we launched if you talk about International Language Day, we launched a campaign or content that where we worked with a community in Bangladesh. I will not talk about the name of the community because for the confidential reasons. But we worked in a community. We saw there is an international group from Russia that working for in the plant and the government with the government. There are a lot of this community who are working there, and couple of there is a communication barrier. So we, together with the local retailers, trained them in that language, and we recreated that language content as a campaign for our International Language Day. Now, if you talk about why did we do this, this is more fits with our, you know, vision that we are empowering the societies. Retailers now can communicate better with the customers in that language. Customers are getting a better service. Overall, that village, that community is improving their livelihood. So this is a mix. And a couple of quarters back, we worked with this sign line language, where we saw that there is a huge community of deaf and dumb. And how we can profoundly deep customers, and they cannot communicate in our customer services. So we created a channel, a portfolio for the profoundly deep customers where we can communicate through the sign language. Now this is again both connects with the purpose and the mission that we are empowering the societies, and you know, we're delivering what matters most to our customers. Now, why am I being these examples? Because this is absolutely critical when we are talking about contents and purpose. Many a times we see that brands, they just mix and match. You know, you do something which is kind of the trendy and in thing, and you just patch it up with the brand, and you know, you see completely irrelevant things. You know, the stories something, and then at the end of the day, it is kind of forcefully attached to the content. That is not actually true content. So that's why we have to live the purpose and understand the customers and then deliver true things.
Thank you, Sajad. It's a great beginning. I mean, in line with that, I believe we can see that Gramophone has been doing it for a long time, and we'd know more about this in our discussion later. I mean, I'd like to go to Alan. Alan, how do you, I mean, as one of the leading FMCG in Bangladesh, I mean, what's the story that you wanted to tell that embeds functionality with the purpose?
First of all, thank you, Nazbul Bhai, for the invitation. It's a pleasure and a delight to be part of this gathering. Nazbul Bhai, like you're aware, Marico is an organization with a portfolio of brands overall. And each of those brands have a different identity of their own and a different task and message of their own, if you were to look at it. I'll talk about it from that context. For us, brand purpose is a journey over time, and it depends on two aspects. One, there is a consumer perspective. What's the larger role that the brand actually plays in the consumer's life in adding value to the consumer's life? That's the consumer perspective. Second, of course, is the brand context per se overall. So there are, the portfolio has brands who are in different stages of their life cycle. There are brands who have different contexts, different competitive contexts, different needs that they address to consumers. And the brand per se has a certain task to do overall. So somewhere both of these will have to come together to identify what purpose will do to each of those brands actually. And from a Marico perspective, for us, our biggest stakeholder is our consumer, their needs, desires, and aspirations, and the role that the brand has in life. And I'd like to talk about one example where we were able to bring both these things together, the consumer perspective and the brand context per se. Like we would be aware, Parachute Advanced is one of the best loved brands in the country. Consumers have a lot of affection to the brand, which has become almost an integral part of the fabric of their lives. And that has a huge amount of bonding with the brand overall. And that's a brand which is very, very strong. In this context, what we have done over the last almost 2 years is a phase of a journey where we have taken the functionality, the brand actually promises strong hair. That's the functionality which is there. We have taken the next leap from there and created a platform called Strong Hair, Strong Bonds, which is a celebration of bonds, a celebration of the bonds that people have with each other. And also, we have leveraged it depending on the context in also inspiring women overall. Like Sajid Bhai was mentioning, we've also taken a strategy of leveraging certain occasions to bring alive this thought. In the last couple of years, we've had the campaign around Mother's Day, we've had it around Friendship Day, we've had it around Women's Day. And I would like to talk a bit about what we did during the Women's Day, which was a great example of how we were able to balance both the functional and still take a higher order purpose. So this year during Women's Day, we actually extended this campaign as Strong Has Strong Bonds, Strong Women. And we said, could we inspire women to go the extra mile? And that was the task with which we started off overall. And we partnered with the country's largest flagship airline, Biman Bangladesh. And we had three of their pilots who became the face of the inspiration to the campaign, actually. So those three pilots became the inspiration. We started that with a digital film, which was about a young girl who had aspirations to fly. She flew higher and higher and achieved her dreams. That was the start of a conversation. And we took that into print, because when we say content, the content can't just be free content. The content will have to view itself holistically. It started with the digital film. It went into print, where there were women and younger girls who were inspired by either their moms or their relatives, who became the face of the campaign. And finally, where did content play a much larger role? We were also able to do a talk show where our brand ambassador, Nabila, interviewed three of these pilots, actually, for a special show and listened to and took in their story. Now, that was a piece which really brought in a lot of emotion and a lot of connect with consumers overall. So somewhere, a brand which was promising strong hair had evolved into a much larger thought, where it was actually inspiring women to actually take a much, much larger path. And the sheer comments, engagement, and the way consumers were having conversations around it was a true testimony of how this could be a beautiful way of continuing that journey and balancing both functionality as well as still taking a higher order stance. So that way, it will both need to come together in a very seamless fashion for such engagement to happen.
Great. I mean, I could find a lot of similarity what Sajjad Bhai has just said and Alan has just said. I mean, that gives us more confidence as a marketeer. I mean, that's that right direction. Now, with that, I'll move on to Romil Bhai, because I could see that he has done some amazing content very recently. There are a lot of discussions going on about this. We'd be very happy to know about that. And with that, I would also like to know, as I said, the practicality and the purpose side of it for creating those great content. Romil Bhai, please.
Thank you, Nazmul Bhai. Very interesting and timely topic that we are discussing. I'm very happy to share with you and others about this. I am representing financial industry. If you look around, we have 60 over banks, around 35 non-banks and other, let's say, insurance companies and other institutions. When you deal with the most precious thing, like, for example, money, the way brand should be more humankind, more purposeful, I think industry is lacking in that perspective a lot. In that area, I would say IDLC, being 36 years old company, we are very, very careful about it. We have been very careful about it. Firstly, I would like to attend the conversation from functionalities to the practicality. That is a huge challenge for us. The other participants here, somehow they represent global companies. Of course, they have global strategies, global purpose statement, vision, mission, and other stuff. For a local company to be a purposeful brand is very challenging. And you have been in the industry, and I think you also know about it.
Sure.
But for us, what we have been practicing, working here for many years, what I can see is, like, whatever we do, we try to find out the reason why do you exist as a financial brand. Do you exist just for making money? Just to say with ego that we serve this many number of customers? Or just to announce that this is mass profit we made? As you can see in a financial brand, this is a very regular topic, how much money we made. Or we want to say something that, why do we come to office? What is the greater purpose of our brand or of our time that we deliver? Yeah. In that sense, I think whenever you work, it starts from the board. First of all, board needs to understand that except making money, brand should have a greater purpose. So IDLC has been very successful about that. Then it comes down to the leadership team. Leadership team has to believe in it. We have been very lucky that they believed in it. And then it follows to the colleagues across the countries that whether they believe in that or not. From there, when we want to execute it, we have, of course, certain difficulties. We face it, but the way we plan it so that everybody understands it, everybody believe in it, and when everybody somehow believe in it, then we can, when we go for implementing it, it becomes very easy. And as far as IDLC is concerned, if you, as you said that you noticed some interesting content recently, this is about the SME loan. We are very much pioneer in this segment. We have been doing SME business for last 15 years very successfully with a greater level of customer satisfaction. So what we thought this time is, we have been giving loans, but we are not telling the stories that how, as an individual, if they want to do business, what are the obstacles they go? And when we say it, it's like it has become like RM to the client relationship manager to the client conversation. It didn't go to the mass level. So this is, we plan that we will come up with 7 short films. And these 7 short films are apparently the inspiration for the SME entrepreneurs. So we partnered with one of the very renowned TV channel. We hired one of the famous director, and then we co-created content. We sat with him. He visited our customers. He spent many hours with us. He understood the business. Then we come up with these short films, and then we launched it. This has been a very successful thing. And I am proud to say that this has not been done by other banks or financial institutions before. Perhaps other industries did it very successfully. Whenever we do campaigns, of course, I, in front of Sajid Bhai, I must say, we try to beat or follow what would Grameenphone would do, what Vikash should do in this perspective. So when we followed it, and it has been very courageous thing, as I said, that our board believed in it, our leadership team believed in it, because this is very non-conventional thing. Instead of doing this, we can go for just running SME TVC on TV channel. That is a very shortcut approach. So we thought people at this critical time in COVID situation, when SME entrepreneurs are affected, we thought that they need inspiration, they need to restart, and to help them, we can come up with this sort of content, and we have been able to do it very successfully.
Thank you so much, Prabal. I mean, I really appreciate the thing that you've been doing. And as you said in the beginning, that it's the multinationals has got their own strategy. And though during those periods when they run things in other countries, they do kind of respect the way the country culture is. But still, it's very challenging for the local organization, and you've done pretty well. And we will come and we'll discuss more about it. Now, I'd like to go to Tanzin Bhai. Before I talk to him about this, I don't want to repeat the questions, but I just want to praise about something that Unilever is a brand. I mean, like we grew up with, and we have observed many campaigns that has gone beyond the functionality always. I mean, when those social purpose or purposeful branding was not into the foray. Create an excitement, I personally, when Tanzin used to handle, I believe, Purit, there were some amazing campaigns I remember that personally has inspired me to bring the product home. So I work in marketing, and I know that I should not be convinced myself very fast when I see something, but it was convincing because I've always found the greater purpose than the product in his storytelling. So, but Tanzin is now in a much bigger role, growing a much bigger role and greater story to tell. I'd be very happy to know how Tanzin, you as a brand marketeer, along with Unilever as a company that believes in purpose, I mean, embedding functionality and the, that means the practicality with the purposeful branding part of it? How are you embedding it?
Yeah, thank you so much. First of all, I just want to say it's such a, I'm so lucky to be here with this, you know, great audience. I mean, I was just thinking, I'm actually a customer of each of your organizations, by the way. So Grameen Phone, to by default, of course, Rajat Bhai, we're all, the entire Unilever family is with you guys. You know, in fact, and Marico products are all over in my home as well. You know, it's a regular core product, you know, it's always there. Very loved brand like Parachute and all. And I recently also became a customer of IDLC as well, Roman Vibe. So it's so great when I heard, okay, I'm going to talk to you in this audience with you guys. It was great because, you know, you understand the community and you're actually purchasing, you're part of that a product, you understand it. So great to be here. So let me start off with our journey of this in Unilever. I think, you know, by default, we used to do a lot of things that was purposeful, but we used to not call them purpose branding when we started, say, I mean, I started in Unilever about, you know, almost now 17 years about almost. And when we started, we used to do a lot of things that we used to call purpose. I think 2010 onwards, probably 7-8 onwards, when our CEO, Paul Polman, he was really passionate about this. And he was really driving the entire world, saying that, you know what, it's bigger than just business for shareholders and all that. But to be honest, I don't want to also be a part of, you know, what now has become purpose washing as well, right? Where you're just doing it for the sake of branding yourself, purpose and all that. The point, if it is, it has to be, first of all, let's be clear. We are all here for business. If there's no revenue and profit, I'm sorry, forget about purpose and all that. Yeah. That's purpose washing. Yeah. So I would actually challenge that, by the way. Well, yes, I would dare to say Unilever is leading in a lot of these things, but we have also been at fault. It's sometimes also not being clear as to how is it driving business. Okay. So a word of caution that before you go jump into purpose, let's be clear that, okay, does this initiative help you get top line and bottom line first and foremost? If it doesn't, you may experiment it, but please go back. Yeah. Don't do it for the sake of the society and all that. That's not our jobs. There are other NGOs and all that to do that. But where I will give you an example of where it worked. And I'll tell you again, it's just terms, because, you know, we have to justify our jobs and salaries. So it's just different terms we are, you know, also sometimes using. So, you know, it's no different than positioning as well, right? Yeah. So we are always doing positioning and all that. It's basically, you ultimately want to capture the share of the hearts of your consumers, share of mind, and leading to share of hearts, right? Because that's the future market share of your brand. Yeah. If you can get the share of heart today, eventually, you know, when you're present and all that, you'll get your share of market. And sometimes, you know, we actually measure it sometimes with matrices like brand power. And I will come back to that later. But what I'm trying to say is that we are always doing positioning. It's just now we are doing it again to differentiate yourself. And you know, in your consumer's mind, you're clear that this is what the brand is standing for something. Now, it used to be just, say, open happiness for Coke and all that. But now you just want to make it a little more impactful because there are so many societal issues that are there that nobody's solving. So I think you also just need to look at, to be practical, what I'm looking at is there are these now societal issues to solve and environmental issues to solve. And there's a culture in your country. Just put that into the table and then look at your brand's business. Where is there an overlap? And then go after it. Yeah. And the example, my favorite example, see, in Unilever, there are these these are health brands, for example, Lifebuoy being the, you know, case study where, of course, I mean, our existence today is so important because of that. But beyond that, you know, so Lifebuoy, Purit, and Domex, hand washing, safe drinking water, and toilet cleaning. That's actually what we call water sanitation hygiene. Those are something that is, I mean, the birth, the reason to live is purpose, right? You're giving health and hygiene. So pretty easy. I'm not going to talk about that. The one brand that I, one of my favorite brands that I used to love working on you know, I was like surprised. Like, I get paid to work for this brand is Surf Excel, or in other parts of the world, it's called Omo. Is that, you know, it believes that only by getting dirty can a child develop fully.
Yeah.
And where is the link to the brand? Because if your child is getting dirty, then its clothes are getting dirty. And then there's Surf Excel, which is removing tough dirt, right? You know, tough stains is what Surf Excel expertise is. What a wonderful positioning for years to come. And that's where we just tried to say, you know, spin it a little. A decade ago, it was about saying that we need, you know, it's about the values that children are learning. Right. So that classic ad where the brother is helping, you know, empathizing with the sister who got covered with mud as she slipped. Right. And then he's trying to kill the mud and all that. So from that onwards, now where we are is we in Bangladesh for the last 3-4 years, what we did was that children are not getting anywhere to play. Dhaka city has only 2% of the children of Dhaka have access to a playground. Yeah. This is a research done by PPRC. And it's a ticking time bomb that we are having for our children. And COVID has made it worse. If it was 2%, then it's 0% right now. Yeah. I was actually late because I took out my daughter for her swimming today. I said, no, nothing happened. We are definitely going for swimming today. So yesterday night, I bought her a cycle and we were cycling at late night. So I'm just saying any opportunity you're going to get, you have to look at their development, because trust me, it's not just studies. Yeah, it's far from it. This is their childhood and they're losing it. So Surf Excel gave me that perfect opportunity that, you know what, do something about children's development. And when you're so clear and purposeful, somehow the stars align and you get partners alike. And what we did was, I was actually looking for something, some partner, and it was a coincidence. I was driving one day in the morning on Friday, and I saw one half of Shangshod Avenue closed by an NGO. They were working, they were doing some stuff and all. And I went and asked and introduced to the founder. And then we talked together. And what happened was we made that platform big, where it was like Surf Excel car free street. So first Friday of every month, we partnered together, closed down the road from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m. to just to communicate to everyone that bring your children over here because you're not getting any place to play, right? It isn't supposed to solve the problem, but it is a start to announce that, you know what, this is what you have to you know, fight for. So that was just a small, again, content, not even, and then there's a lot of content over there, but you're clear about what you're trying to do. So that's just an example of, and after that, of course, you know, a lot of other things went and to make this platform bigger. So that's my example.
Thank you, Tanzim Bhai. I mean, it's very inspirational. I mean, the top marketers of the country, kind of all of them telling the story that the purpose should drive what we are doing, but also need to look at the business side of it. And keeping that in mind, I'm heading to my second questions, which I think that it's a little controversial that what Tanzim has just said and Sajid Bhai initiated and all reiterated, that a lot of time the purpose are embedded into the campaign. So it happens that the CMO hold the ownership, and it's now, and then a lot of time it becomes a lip service where marketing seems to be the self-indulgence, but the organization doesn't hold that, right? So it gets reflected in the customer service. It gets reflected in when you sell something. It gets reflected in the supply chain. It has its own reflection. How do you treat your employees? And then the perception that you build through your purpose-driven persona to the market, it doesn't hold the same status, or it doesn't hold the same perception how consumers feel about it, but because they're smart. Now, looking at that, what I would like to come to Sajid Bhai, that how do you believe that, I mean, as a CXO level manager, how do you think that it should be holistic, that you should roll out things from the organization, as because that becomes your content, the way you portray your campaigns through your content marketing, rather than making it a gimmick from the team of marketing? What's your take on that?
Yeah, that's a very good point, Nazmul Bhai. First of all, in Grameenphone, brand is actually not my property or something that I work. In Grameenphone, it is actually owned by the CEO.
Excellent.
So, because it has to start from the top. the brand itself is not only about the contents and campaigns. It's about the delivery. It's about the products. It's about how our employees represent the outside world, how the retailer serves the customer, how the agent in the call center answers to specific queries, from communication to products to solving problems. Everything is brand. And if I'm just talking about superior customer service and experience in the ads, and my agent in a distant thana is misbehaving with the customer or not living up to the brand purpose, that brand dies at the very own shop. And even in different stakeholder meetings, if my employees are not living up the brand image, that dies in those desks. So it is very important. We strongly believe that brand should be in the ownership of the CEO or managing director, whatever the role is. And then it should be lived from top to bottom. And that's how the CEO should talk, the MD or managing director should talk about the brand, that what does the purpose stands for and how do we connect. So when that happens, this becomes very, very easy, I would say. But if only the CMO is the person who is talking about the brand and the purpose, nothing gonna make it successful, because some other parts will be continuously disconnected and you will not be able to serve the purpose. And now when that happens, and then we talk about the contents and activities, then customers can really feel it. They can really feel it. I really get a lot of pride when a customer visits a kind of a call center or a customer care center and sends me a note in the social media. She doesn't know me, but still she drops a line. I received one today as well. That is an appreciation. I received today one, I will tell you a live example. Today I received one message in my Facebook. I don't know her. She sent me an appreciation of her activities, and she mentioned there is a small spelling mistake in your MyGP app in one of the pages inside. It's not in the front, but in the very inside, there is a spelling mistake you should correct. And I was like, I was really grateful to her that this is, I don't know her. She's just a customer, regular customer. She felt the need and she communicated that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That is what we believe, that is how we should touch our customers. There are upsides, there are downsides. For example, I would say one example, which is not very something, because I am also learning, right? I am new to this world. I just became CMO last year and I'm still learning. And when I am there, I started changing a lot of things. I will do this, I will do that. And then last year we did a campaign where we tried to, change the social strata around women. That women, why should they be, left around and have a different social culture? So we ran a campaign like Interneter Shoktite Chailei Shombo, Poriborton Chailei Shombo. And it was a very decent campaign where we presented that women can work in the society and with the power of technology, she can be free. But I tell you, it was not well accepted by the customers, a huge community where there were people who were positive, there were people who were negative. And we saw that, we have the purpose to empower societies, but the way customers would like us to do, maybe it's not the same. So there are things we should be really understanding our customers' emotion and then how to connect these purposes. I would say this is really, really important to do that.
Thank you, sir. I mean, on that perspective, I would like to ask the same question to Romel Bhai, in terms of how, because we are part of an industry, as we both worked in the financial service industry, we know that the comment from the CEO, the analysis from the CEO, works a lot as the thought leadership content. And then also for many of us, here we have a representation from Marico and from Unilever. We all know that anything that CEO brings out, it creates a spark, right? Because it represents the company and all. So, but when to a lot of companies is because you represent the local organization, that a lot of time we see that this social purpose or purpose branding that comes from the house of CXO. So, and it becomes a lip service. And then how do you manage it in IDLC? I mean, and how do you look at it? What's your view on that?
Thank you, Nazmul Bhai. Fantastic question. As you rightly pointed out, this has become the lip service in, I would say, many local companies. What I feel is, and what we follow is mainly, you should not serve the food if you don't cook well. Anything, if you do not do integrated, if you do not do the holistic plan, you should not just announce it for the sake of announcing it. So for us, I think it's not about the CEO. It has to be entire CXO team has to believe in it. And since they are not going to be the in the field to execute it, so our other colleagues, those who are working different branches, different cities, they need to believe in it. And for this, we need to communicate, we need to train them up, we need to make them believe. Instead of doing that, we should not do any product launch or any campaign launch. That's what we thoroughly follow and we test it. Another thing is we follow is like, we don't just become trendy. Like if you look around, International Women Day, SME Day, Father's Day, Mother's Day, just because Grameenphone has done something for International Women, do we have to do it Father's Day, Mother's Day? Yeah. Perhaps Grameenphone or Unilever or Marico have done something with proper actions. And you or I cannot just randomly come and announce it that, okay, today we respect all the SME entrepreneurs who have been taking this economy forward, this and that. However, if you check them, perhaps they didn't do much lot of SME financing. They didn't go and enable them. So that thing we always follow, and we are very particular about it. Let me put an example. We are the perhaps first venture capital fund that we are helping the local startups. We have got the approval of 45 crore taka, and we already disbursed to some local startup, and they have been doing fantastic. And we are in talk with some other major players as well, but we don't announce it. We could announce it, but our motto is, this is the fund, we are giving it to you. However, whatever the promise you made to the customers, your customers, you first try to deliver it. Then as a brand, we can say, because if you look at it, 45 crore taka is not much. So one type of brand could be call the press and say, this is what we are doing. Another type of brand could be you give this fund to right companies, you enable them, you train them up, you help them to be the part of greater ecosystem, then you announce it, then it would be very sustainable. So IDLC has always been the believer in it, but this is a struggle because sometimes as a CMO, I also get the little bit of pressure, some sort of pressure, this brand is doing that, this brand is doing that. But I try to convince my other colleagues and CEO that, do you want to do just for the one go, or do you want to do something for the long run? And whenever we do something, for example, International Women's Day, we are very particular about it. How many hours of training we have given to the root level women entrepreneur, how many customers we have increased. And you will find that perhaps IDLC has disbursed the largest amount of fund to the women entrepreneurs as far as Bangladesh Bank's data. But then again, we try to be humble. We try to, we believe that we did not do much. But instead of, if we do a bit of little and we announce it, it doesn't work long run. And for us, as you rightly found out, it's very challenging because Unilever or Grameenphone or Marico, they have different, you know, check and balance levels. For us, perhaps that we don't need to check in a different levels. So here, CEO and CXO have to be very careful and look at the long-term horizon instead of the short-term horizon.
Thank you, Ramal Bhai. I mean, now in the next question, I would like to narrow it down to two of our leading experts from the FMCG. So I'll go to Alan at first, where it's another controversial question because I grew up in an agency, then I get into the brand role. to the other side. So I find that while growing up in the agency side and also working in the industry, we had a lot of dependency on our advertising agencies or creative partners. But that agency model probably is not sustainable anymore, because we need, when it comes to content, when it needs to be fresh, when it needs to be cause-driven, it needs to have a lot of ownership, right? And when you create engaging and useful content, a lot of time you cannot really wait to brief and that things get cooked and come to you in 2 days later, 4 days of approval. But then you have to deliver, right? And also you need to go through the legal process. My question to you, Alan, is in the beginning, that what do you think? I mean, should we follow the advertising agency model, the partnership model, to create our purpose campaign where they don't hold probably the similar ownership that we hold for our brand? Or we should create, or the culture should be there where there the brand team has its own creative toolbox or creative kitchen where things would happen faster, more agile, and also with the cause that you really hold in your heart. What do you think, Alan? And what should we be doing?
Nakhulbhai, here I beg to differ a bit overall. So I believe that our agency partners are partners, just the way we call them. It's a partnership overall. And we are of a very, very firm belief that brands are co-owned by us and equally owned, co-owned by the agency partner, which means the ownership is joint overall. So when we work with partners, we work long-term. They understand what is needed. They understand the consumer. And that understanding and that synergy is extremely critical. If that is not there, then we will have a challenge overall. And the minute it's there, like for instance, with our digital partner, with some of our creative agency partners, there what we definitely do is we push each other. We push each other to bring out excellence. We push each other to drive purpose and drive what is necessary for the brand at that point of time. It's not a matter of saying only the brand team needs to take ownership. I would think that both of us need to have equal ownership. And the minute that synergy is there at all levels, right from the brand manager to the CMO, right up to the MD, at all levels, when that synergy is there, it delivers brilliantly. It delivers beautifully. And we've seen that time after time after time. I can give you an example of a brand, Parachute Just for Baby, overall. Now, this is a brand we had launched a couple of years overall. And there, at the heart of the brand itself is a larger need today among moms, which is safety of the baby and safe baby care products. That was the large need that we uncovered overall. And as an organization, we committed towards it. The minute we committed towards it, we partnered with agency who actually created an entire content platform. The entire content platform, which is hosted on a website called justforbaby.co, that entire platform is actually run by our agency partner. It's not run, and in tandem, synergistically with the branding overall. So both of us have worked together beautifully. Like they understand it. Yes, there will always be a period initially when there'll be a lot of handholding, and there might be a need for exchange of thoughts. There might be alternate points of view. It will take certain time. The minute the guardrails are set, the minute the principles are set, after that, it's a beautiful synergy overall. And that's how we've also been able to land and consistently build on that thought and build on that platform. And it's a huge content platform. There's content happening week after week, month after month. And still, because we have amazing partners who work closely with us, it's possible to do that.
Thank you, Alan. I mean, it's very inspiring. I'll tell you why I have asked this question. I mean, but prior to that, I'd like to go to Tanzim Bhai, because I've always found him someone who believed in partnership. And Unilever is also a solid example of how actually to grow partnership, where sometimes you cannot probably separate what's an agency and what's the organization. So, and the reason that I'm asking this question, because the young audience who is, like listening to us today, a lot of time they're in dichotomy that they have probably learned from their senior management that, well, you need to manage your cost. Like, don't go to an agency. They would cost you a lot. Do something in-house. And then suddenly they bring something which just doesn't reflect what their insights is telling them. Or, and also there are a lot of time you destroy the brand immediately when you do things by yourself. So the reason that Unilever has been leading this, and also we have Sajid Bhai and Romal Bhai, who believes in this partnership model. How do you define that? But there could be another way of looking at it as well, because agility is an issue when we develop great content. When we're working for a cause, it's very important that the way the relationship with the cause or the passion for the cause is imbibed in CEO's heart or the board's heart probably could not be translated well to the agency, right? So where, Tanzim Bhai, you see the scope of improvement and also where to go, please.
Yeah, so again, I'm not going to comment on whether it's in-house agencies better or remaining outside, because actually, if I say either, there are actually cases, good examples for either side, basically, right? So yeah. That depends on your strategy. Yeah, I mean, there are good cases for both the sides, by the way, okay? So I'm not commenting on that. It's a more strategic choices that the culture of that organization actually, desires, okay? I personally think that I'm a bit always self-critical and a bit critical about our own point of view, basically. So I'll tell you where, sorry, do I have you guys on? Okay, yeah, no, I don't have, there's more freezing here. No, what I was saying is that quite often where we fail as marketeers is not being able to translate our vision or clearly share the passion and the brief and the personality of the brand with the agencies. I think there's a huge gap and there's a huge noise between the client and the agency, okay? Yeah. And that happens because there's actually lack of clarity within the client. If you ask often, sometimes, if you ask, what does a brand stand for? What is a brand positioning? In Unilever, there's something called a brand key. If you there, sometimes, sometimes, actually from a brand manager to a senior brand manager to a category head to a marketing director, you might have some discrepancy around what does a brand stand for. And there might, imagine the confusion within, right? So how do you actually criticize an agency when they said, okay, when you've briefed and said, this is what they brought in, and you're like, okay, this is not what my brief was. But have you actually questioned yourself that how clear and inspiring were we in briefing the agency? Okay, we actually have to hold ourselves to a higher standard, saying that, you know what, agencies have 100 brands to look after. The brief that you send, is it in the top of his mind, the top three things that he wants to do right now, because he's been so inspired by your brief? Yeah. So all I'm saying is that the clarity and inspiration in the briefing is, there's a lot of work to be done from the client side before we hold our agencies accountable. I'm not saying that they are also not accountable. It takes two to clap your hands. Yeah. But before we go to that stage, let's hold ourselves accountable in making. And I'll just say, give you an example of two of my favorite brands, where when I was in India, working over there, I saw Amul, right? That they had to basically come up with an ad and be contextual with the current scenario every day. So something happened yesterday night, the agency was empowered, right? On a different level, not the empowerment we know, to actually come up with a campaign and put it up on paper, right?
Absolutely.
So it's there and then right away, agency has been empowered. I don't think any of us has the balls to do what Amul does, okay? So it takes balls to do that, one. And two, the other one was, I was reading Pandemonium, so over there, Mr. Pandey said that Fevicol was so clear what Fevicol stood for that one day the T-boy came and said, sir, I have an idea. And then he gave an idea, and that got executed, right? Because right from the client to the agency's key boy was clear what the brand stood for. I don't think we have that clarity. No. So I'll say that.
Great answer. I mean, there are a lot of responsibility that the brand manager needs to take as a custodian. I mean, would you like to add something, Sajid Bhai? I mean, because you sort of we know as Grameenphone that you guys have your in-house and also you've been working with all the leading comms agencies as a partner and developing them, and also got a lot of ideas executed from there. And would you like to have any point of view, different or similar?
No, I would not add different. I will go with Tanzin Bhai the way he described. Actually, it's about how closely we are working with the agency. We do have an internal creative team, but that's not actually for our big campaigns or more, you know, revolutionary ones. Those are obviously with the agencies, because we do need a lot of insights, a lot of creativity, technology. Those are not actually, it's not worthwhile investing for this inside the company, where you can actually buy them from abroad. And we have, you know, international and local both agencies working with us, and it's a great idea. But the key fact is, how are you working closely with the agencies? I sit with Shaun Bhai every, you know, every month, and discussing about the brand strategy, what should be taking the next. I am there present when the team is briefing on the major campaigns, because I would like to see that whether I understand the brief or not as well. If I don't understand, how could the agency understand? So in the last, in the March campaign, when we are launching our biggest campaign of this year, which is the 100% 4G campaign, but we covered the entire nation with all the 4G capability. We sat endless times with agencies, number of times, just to make sure that all of us are on the same page. And boy, they have delivered brilliantly. So it's about communication, over communication, and ensuring that they are as one team. And that's it. An internal creative team is there just to save us a day when we are in deep trouble, or, you know, need of an agility, the way you mentioned.
Thank you.
But it's mostly great. Outside.
Great answer. I mean, the reason that I brought these issues, as I said in the beginning, because something which is which you need to create is a culture in organization. And I believe that Romil agrees. I'm not going to ask the same question to him, because we've both worked for local companies. There, time to time, those practices at times get skilled by different people, right? So, and then this audience is who is going to listen to us today. They need to feel that the lot of responsibility comes to the custodians, who need to embed this culture in terms of creating great brands. Otherwise, if you don't have partners, you can't create great contents, and you cannot even hold on to the thoughts and the feeling of your user generated content either. So we are almost out of time. Just my last question, probably just like a quick thought. I don't want something which is very analytical, because it's a question that probably needs a long answer, but I just want a very quick thought out of you, that how do you measure the impact of the content with purposeful branding when you strategize your brand roadmap? I mean, because as Tanzin began saying that if there is no business, whatever purpose you have, it's not going to work. So I'd like to ask Romil in the very beginning, that Romil Bhai, like, how do you measure the impact? You said about it, but if there are something which in one or two lines you can say that, well, this is the impact that IDLC has observed over the year, that's the purposeful branding that they have done, because you've done great things on purpose, you know. Romil Bhai, if you probably could enlighten us.
Nazmul Bhai, since you have restricted me to one and two line, I'll answer it one and two line.
For the sake of time, I wanted a long answer.
Yes, very simply, for a financial brand, let's say it's a critical time when your deposit rate is lower than your competitors. Do people still trust you and deposit their money with you?
Yeah.
If you can see this number is rising, you are getting the same level of deposit from the customers, you can understand that people believe in you. That's why they have kept money. Excellent. And why people believed in you? Because your brand had a great purpose and has a great purpose.
Thank you. Thank you. Alan, what do you think? I mean, how would you? I mean, should I call Alan Bhai? Because I don't know. I mean, the name is something different. I could say bye to everyone.
Alan is perfect.
Alan Bhai, yes.
Nazmul Bhai. Okay. Sure. So I think it begins with defining the role very, very sharply. If we, definition of the role of what we are doing towards the equity of the brand. So being where we are, if we define that sharp, if we have that sharpness, it's very clear. Wherever the sharpness has lacked, it always is a question mark overall. I think it begins with defining it very sharply. Like, for example, on Parachute Just for Baby, so safety as a measure metric has to go up overall. So which means the equity that entire platform, everything does, towards safety is what translates in. So it will be long term. It has to be long term. It may not completely be short term only, but commitment, conviction towards it, and ultimately tracking it on equity measures is very important, which in turn need to translate into choice overall. So it's a two-step. That's how we would see it overall, rather and see it over a period of time.
Thank you, Alan Bhai. Sajad Bhai, would you like to add?
No, one point, there is a change going on considering the one decade ago, we would like more rely on the surveys and TRP figures and all those things. Today, our marketing technology and analytics are really, really strong. And it gives us what Alan Bhai and Roman Bhai talked about. I would add up just like we have also, I'm sure Tanzin Bhai, I know that, Unilever digital marketing is also very strong. It can be tracked in a very, very meticulous level from daily to a long-term level. At a long-term end, you have the brand equity and all those studies. But on a daily level, you can be seeing the sensitivity analysis and the trackers and everything, which can lead up to the brand equity and the long-term pacts. So for us now, marketing looks at figures just like sales every day, every week, every month, every quarter, and every year. And then it adds up. If something goes wrong in the daily or monthly or quarterly, you are sure that you have to do some corrections. So that's pretty fascinating these days.
So Sajabha, do you think that this social or community listening is going to be the social currency for the brand very soon?
Of course. Because as I said, you do one thing wrong, you can get indications immediately. And if you're not acting on those indications, you are doomed. And it can really cost you in the long run. So why wait for that? And it's very, very interesting to follow these trends and understand what's going on. And it's actually the voice of your customers.
Great. Tanzim Bhai, I mean, I know that how Unilever measure every single thing. I mean, we grew up seeing how and why media is so important to brands like Unilever. They kind of train us who has worked in brands in the beginning of our career, even when we were in the agency, to look at media measurement and all. So with this changed perspective, when social media is leading at the moment, or I would say that hold a lot of share of voice, in that case, how and where you see this measurement is happening? I mean, what impact?
No, so globally, we have standardized measurement processes. So we have sustainability index that, again, through mind measures are tracked every quarter. And there are purpose statements that we also track for every brand because there's linked. For example, does child's develop Surf Excel helps for a child's development, or do you agree on these? So for example, there will be those purpose statements that are tracked and eventually leading to one holistic figure that we keep on measuring, which is a Kantar figure. It's called brand power, and it's globally tracked where we see if your brand power is increasing, that's a future revenue and market share opportunity. So what we've seen is that actually just recently, because that was also debated internally all over the world, that does purpose campaigns improve your brand power? And it's actually been proven that purpose campaigns actually have a bigger impact on brand power improvement than non-purpose campaigns. So that was one, evidence-led marketing initiative that we had. The other one, which was much more easily for me to understand, was when we did some, again, as Sajad was saying, digital marketing initiatives. For example, the last one, which was on Taza, we had a campaign around the end product was women empowerment, where we were saying that when women are oppressed in situations, especially where there's an unfair situation and a man is involved, women can't come back with a equally same reaction. So they have to be witty in that respect. So the campaign was wit for tat, right? Rather than tit for tat, wit for tat. So with the Taza campaign that is currently on air, right? You see, it's a Bandarban Pathadibo and everything. Now it is basically where we have in the airport TVC. So here, what we've seen when we are playing this on digital platforms, they had higher engagements than other campaigns, very easily. It was like very stark that all other campaigns are here, and then the campaigns which had purpose and that had higher engagement. So that immediately gives you a confidence that, you know what, go after this. And it is working. So that's where I will leave it.
Great. I mean, great. I believe that I personally very enjoyed, I mean, enjoyed this session, because a lot to learn. A lot of time when we run the brands, we get confused. And then when we come to the panel like this, we probably talk to each other and learn from each other and leave a great example for our audiences where, sure, Tanzim,
Sorry. Before you suddenly end, I just wanted to actually, when you're starting this session, I just take 2 minutes, just one request to the panel here as well, because, you know, it's not often that all these marketing heads are coming together. And to Sajjad Bhai, Alan, and Romel, I have a request. You know, and it's last month was Olympics, right? And, you know, I used to actually, I'm very passionate about various sports. And I used to get up at like 5 a.m., 6 a.m. I watched the live, you know, archery match where Dia just missed it in the penalty session, basically. from table tennis to swimming, and all saw that. And you know, I think we all know that 160 plus million population, we still have no medals, right? And the way that in our neighboring country, the way they are approaching this in such a systematic manner, actually, you know, I saw that the javelin thrower, right, who got gold, Niraj, right? The way, I think Alan would know, the JSW Cement Company and all that, they have done an Inspire Institute of India, where they've come and invested in these sports. And I'm just saying, you know, we're talking about purpose and all that. Here, there's one thing unifying. This is for the country. Yeah. And, you know, all of these, I just wish we could actually pick up Olympic sports. And I'm saying, by the way, the other point is actually invest. Again, I'm going back to children's development. I'm actually being very selfish. Like, you know, my children, I don't want them to be involved in more sports. I think we all want all of our children to be in sports. And if some of them get to be, you know, really interested in one sport, my daughter is interested in badminton. You know, she's really passionate about it. I was like, okay, I'm going to put you under professional coaching.
Absolutely.
So then get some of them into their professional coaching, fund them, and actually go for a concerted matter. Can we come to this? Can we all get to support on this, basically? It's one area I'm actually requesting everyone to chip in, because sports can actually solve a lot of societal issues. We're actually going to face, our youth is going to face issues around violence, drugs, all these things are coming up. And I think one of the ways to do that is coordinated effort around sports and maybe around Olympic sports, because we need diversity. Absolutely. It's not just cricket and football. Yeah. We need them to get a sampling of various sports that are there. So just wanted to leave that thought behind.
Great insight, Tanzim Bhai. I mean, this sort of discussion should come forward. And we believe that, I mean, when a brand deals with the purpose and articulates that what people should buy, I mean, a lot of time, brands could probably take up the social issues, as you said. And many a times today, it has been uttered that we should take one particular cause, one particular issue. And if each of these brands, strong brands, who has the capability to transform, and we could possibly make things which is not possible by a person, right? I mean, so as an enterprise, as an organization, or as an also some of the top marketing in the industry, you could probably create that inspiration to take up a cause, work for it, and work really seriously, and then stand for it, because we should strive to make things better, not just to make better things. So with that note, thank you, everyone. I'd like to thank Brand Forum for organizing Content Marketing Conference, and also to offer us the opportunity again to meet, to hear from some of the leading experts on this very pertinent subject. And I believe that it has, the way I feel inspired today listening to all of you, I believe that our audience will feel inspired. And from there, if somebody just work on one single cause, and if it can drive that momentum, as just Tanzim has just said, we would be very successful. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, dear panelists. And thank you, our awesome audience who passionately has listened to us today. Thank you.
Thank you to the moderator and panelists for an amazing session.